All right, good morning, everyone. I know we're about a minute and a half early, but that's okay, too. Can we all please stand and we'll go ahead and do our morning pledges? We're all ready? I pledge allegiance to the Bible, God's holy word. I will make it a lamp unto my feet, a light unto my path, and will hide its words in my heart that I might not sin against God. To our Christian flag, I pledge allegiance to the Christian flag and to the Savior for whose kingdom it stands, one Savior, crucified, risen, and coming again. To the American flag, I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. May I have the choir up, please? Y'all please stand as the choir comes down. Amen. Folks, we got a lot of people we need to be praying for today. From what I've heard, we've had a few vehicle accidents over the weekend. A couple of people have been injured. So we certainly need to remember all these folks that may be involved in that and their families. Do we have any special prayer requests anybody would like to make mention? Amen. Yeah, remember Bertha Hatmaker. Anybody else, please? Yes. Amen. Don Fields, let's remember him. Anyone else? I'm sorry? Amen. Yes. Go ahead, Dr. Landon. Amen. Anyone else, please? Amen. Remember Bruce and Joyce this morning? Anyone else, please?
Remember our dad.
Yes.
Lost.
Yes.
Thank God for our country.
Amen. Let's pray that God directs it back on the same path and he forgives us for what we've done wrong already. You know, unfortunately, our world has turned to sin and only God can bring us out of it.
Yes.
Anyone else, please? Yes, remember. Yes, Sister Robin, Mitch, and their family. Anyone else, please? I heard something. Where? Maggie. Okay, sorry, Maggie. My ears is not tuning in very well this morning. Amen. Let's remember that. Like I say, folks, we've got many, many needs out there that we just need to pray for one another. Amen. Anyone else before we go to the Lord in prayer? Yes, amen. Yes. Anyone else? Yes. Amen. Anyone else? All unspoken, all that will, let's please come into the altar, please.
Amen. May I have the men up for the morning offering, please? Brother Jerry, I'll ask you to say the blessing. Amen. Amen. As far as I know, we don't have any new announcements to make at this moment. So, anybody have a special song upon their heart? Looks like Anthony or whoever. You have a song? Praise the Lord. Come on, girl. Would you like a microphone?
Thank you. I'll say this song came to me today, this morning. It's one of the older hymns. And it just reminds me of what Jesus said to Peter. It says, upon this rock I will build my church.
Yes, sir.
And that rock is Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Rock of ages, cleft for me. Let me hide myself in thee. Let the water and the blood from thy riven side which flowed be of sin the double cure. Cleanse me from its guilt and power. Not the labors of thy hand can fulfill thy law's demand. Could my zeal no respite know, could my tears forever flow, all for sin could not atone. Thou must save, and thou alone. Nothing in my hand I bring, simply to thy cross I cling. Naked come to thee for dress, helpless look to thee for grace. Foul I to the fountain fly. Wash me, Savior, or I die. While I draw this fleeting breath, when my eyes shall close in death, when I soar to worlds unknown, see thee on thy judgment throne, rock of ages cleft for me, let me hide myself in thee.
Tell you what, I feel the sweet Holy Spirit already this morning. Praise God. Anybody else have a special song on their heart this morning? I'm sorry, Margaret? Come on. Margaret? William? You've been nominated. Jerry, you're next. No. You've already got a no up here, so. Who knows? At least we tried. Anybody have a testimony there while we're waiting? All right, go right ahead. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Yeah. There you go. Praise God. Every one of us should be shouting the housetops down here today. I tell you, just the thought of meeting our blessed Savior, the one who bled and died for me and for you. You know, that's something we all should be just shouting the housetop down. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. Anyone else have a special song or a testimony you would love to share this morning? Our Lord would love to hear you. Anyone else? Brother Bobby? Are y'all mic'd up yet? Amen, brother.
Amen.
Teresa, you got a song? No? Jerry, I will ask for you, but you've already been struck out, so sorry. I thought we had somebody else here that would sing, but that's okay. Come on, brother.
That ain't gonna happen. Amen.
What a blessing to be in God's house this morning.
Amen. Thank God.
And I'm telling you what a blessing it has been. Appreciate all the good singing. Mom, you surprised me this morning. We need to have a little bit more of that. I would say she got her singing ability from me, but that no need in lying in the pulpit. I have so enjoyed all that. I love it when God's peace just comes over His people. Amen. Amen. I want to start out doing something just a little bit different this morning. I'd like to recognize all of our veterans. I get to thinking from time to time, we'd have no freedom in this country was it not for our veterans. And it's not just those that serve, it's the family. Because the family has to go on when their soldier is deployed. So at this time, like all of our veterans, if you've ever served in whatever branch, would you please just stand to your feet? Amen. Mr. Bob, where did you serve? U.S. Army. Jack? Marine Corps. Anthony? U.S. Army, Marine Corps. Jim? U.S. Army. Amen. Scott, there you are. I can't tell if he's standing or sitting from back here. U.S. Army.
Thank God for you.
What I'd like to say is, these are our heroes right here. God bless you. Thank you for that. Because it is these men and their families and the women that serve. It's not your musicians. It's not famous people. It's these men right here who put on a uniform, took an oath, and served wherever the government sent them. We owe the freedoms in this country to men and women like that.
Yes. Amen.
Amen.
Yes.
And you can't do enough. And I'm so sorry that the country has turned her back.
Yes, sir.
Amen. Anyone else? Man, take that coat off because I get hot easily, and I want everybody to see this orange tie. Amen. Absolutely.
Amen.
And we stood for God and we stood for it. Amen. I was having a conversation with one of our saints this morning. It's not until you get to the big cities and foreign countries do you realize what a blessing it is to be in Campbell County. We're country. We can be called names. Maybe we are poor. But we don't have to deal with some of the things major cities and foreign countries do. And sometimes being ignorant of those things is one of the biggest blessings there is. Amen. You find blessings where they are. Let's go to Matthew chapter 20, verse 29, where I was at last Sunday night, and I want to try to finish up a little more on that. Matthew 20, verse 29. And as they departed from Jericho, a great multitude followed him, and behold, two blind men sitting by the wayside, when they heard that Jesus passed by, cried out, saying, "Have mercy on us, O Lord, thou son of David." And the multitude rebuked him because they should hold their peace, but they cried the more, saying, "Have mercy on us, O Lord, thou son of David." And Jesus stood still and called them and said, "What will ye that I shall do unto you?" They say unto him, "Lord, that our eyes may be opened." So Jesus had compassion on them and touched their eyes, and immediately their eyes received sight, and they followed him. Father God, as we bow before you, thank you for your blessings, for your presence and your power in this church this morning. Thank you, Lord, for each and every one that's here. Father, we pray that you would search out our hearts this day. God, that we would be obedient to your will in each of our lives this morning. We pray for the power of God upon this message, for the words to say. And we'll be so very careful to give you all the praise, honor, glory for it. In Christ Jesus' precious holy name we do pray. And amen. I get asked from time to time, sometimes you preach and you got a title to it, and sometimes you don't. Well, here's your title. Don't ever give up. Because here's what happens. You don't get the results you're praying about. Well, I guess it ain't God's will. If you've got a breath in your body and you got a heartbeat in your body, the only voice you need to listen to ain't yours, the multitudes, or the critics, or the devils. It's Jesus. Amen. Until he says quit praying about it, you don't quit praying and you don't give up. Thou gave you some of it last Sunday night. You got two blind men sitting together. They understand one another. They have compassion one for another. They understand the struggles that each of them are going through. They've been beggars. They've been blind. They've been cast aside. They've been set aside while the rest of the world keeps going. You ever felt like that because of your age, because of your sickness, because of something that you're going through? The world keeps going and they just pass you by like you don't exist. And this is what the multitude was doing to these two men. They were doing nothing wrong. They had every right to call on God, just like the multitude that says, "Hush, call on God." What I'm trying to tell you is this. It don't matter who you are, how you were raised, what your family is, your circumstances. You got a right to call on Jesus. You've got a right to pray. You've got a right to have a hope. You've got a right to expect a victory. You have a right to call Jesus by his name and tell your need to him. And the crowd is saying, just hush, don't bother him. I can promise you that anybody in that multitude would not have wanted to have been shushed when they needed something, when they had a prayer request. But here's the problem. They already had their prayers answered. They are the multitude of, "My prayer's been answered. I'm following him." Not everybody's had their prayer answered yet. Not everybody gets to be in the multitude. Not everybody's had opportunity to follow Jesus. And they have a greater desire than the people who are following him. You understand what I'm saying? It's the prayer you ain't got answered yet is the most important prayer that you're going to pray. Because you still got a need that ain't been met, but you need that need met. And sometimes Jesus takes longer than we want him to take. But he's always on his way. And that multitude kept saying, "Be quiet." And then, I'm going to tell you something. When somebody tells you to hush up on something that's close to you, that's dear to you, that you need, It won't go away. That ought to make you more determined than ever to not shush up and to keep praying, because the only ears that need to you worry about hearing your prayer are the ears of the Savior that can answer your prayer. The multitude can't do it. The crowd can't do it. The critics can't do it. The test results can't do it. But bless God, there's a Savior that walks among us to this day that can still stop, come to where you are, answer that prayer. You call His name. He's the prayer answering God. He's the one that makes it better. He's the one that you need to be worried about. You just keep praying to Jesus, because praying to the multitude don't help. Popular opinion has never answered a prayer. And sometimes you're going to find yourself is the only voice crying out on your behalf. Don't give up. Because if the need is still there, the Savior's still there, and bless God, your prayer ought to still be right there. So let anybody ever tell you to not pray for something when you've got a desire to pray for it. Your prayer request is just as important to Jesus as somebody else's prayer request. Your prayer request means more to you than it means to anybody else. I don't care how much you say, I'll pray with you, I'll pray for you, I'll help you pray about it. It means more to you than it does to somebody that doesn't need that particular need being met. No matter how many times say, I'll help you carry your burden, it's still their burden. I'll help you pray about it, it's still their need that needs to be met. Don't give up. You keep praying. Give up. Don't answer nothing. Let me just pick up where I left off, if I could just remember that was. I want to say this. The crowd had their needs met, but I want to pick up on this. Is that no matter how much they said shush, no matter how much they said shut up, no matter how much they say don't bother him, no matter how much they say we don't want to hear you, no matter how much they said your prayer ain't as important as ours, no matter how much they were told they were insignificant, it didn't matter. Jesus didn't have time for them. I want to tell you this, your prayer rises above everybody else's hate. It don't matter if it means nothing to them or not. Jesus died for your sins. He died for your prayer request. He died for your answer. You are just, God said, there's no big ones and little ones in heaven. What God is saying, ain't nobody means any more to me than somebody else does. God doesn't have any favorites. Everybody's His favorite. Your prayer means something to the Lord Jesus Christ. And they said, don't. How is it? How is it that you got two blind men? Nobody can meet their need but Jesus. He is standing right there, but the crowd says, quit praying. You can't get any better circumstance than when Jesus is standing right there in front of you. What would you, this is what I like, what would you have me to do for you? Now, I'm going to skip ahead whether I get to it or not. That was Jesus' prayer request to them. Are you hearing me? He opened up the door and said, what do you want? That was, if there ever was a time in the Bible where you name it and claim it, it was right there. Whatever they asked for, Jesus said, tell me what I can do. That's when you got the attention of the Master, church. That's when He's on the bow of your boat. That's when He's answering your prayer. That's when He's standing to face the storm you can't face. You see, He's standing there. What would you have? What I'm trying to tell you is this. No matter who else's voices are here, no matter who else you're hearing, no matter what else is going on, you listen to that still small voice that speaks to your heart, that bypasses the ears, that bypasses the shut-ups, that bypasses the forget about it, that bypasses the just give up on your dream, give up on your vision, give up on your burden, give up on your prayer ever being answered. It's that voice when He whispers to you. He cuts through all the nonsense of the world and speaks to that heart. He says, now I'm listening. It's all about you. The world comes to a standstill because when Jesus stood still, nothing else mattered to Him but those two blind men. What I'm telling you is this, when Jesus passes by, you cry out the more. That ain't the time to be quiet. That ain't the time to give up. That ain't the time to say, don't worry about it. Don't pray about it. Just forget about it. Just go on, because Jesus may not circle back around again. When He's there, that's when you call His name, because He's there for you. And He did something. This is something else I'm going to preach my way back up to. The only time in the Bible tells us that Jesus stood still was for these two blind men. The crowd would have kept walking. You ever notice the world really don't care about you? This world don't care if you ever get a prayer answered or not. They don't care if you get healed. They don't care if you get better. They don't care if you get saved. They don't care if your needs are ever met. They don't care about you. And the truth of it is, there's time that Christianity ain't got time for you. Amen. Everybody's busy. Everybody's got their own needs. Everybody's got their own burdens. Everybody's got their own life. We'll try to work you in if we can. Don't expect too much, because when you do it for somebody else, what you're doing is you're giving them whatever time you're willing to set aside for somebody else. Jesus said, I got all the time in the world just for you. You see, prayer always rises above hate. Prayer rises above I don't care. Prayer rises above any disappointment. Prayer rises above any circumstance. Prayer rises above any past sins. Prayer rises above every obstacle between you and your answer. Prayer always rises. I've heard this. It don't exist. My prayers ain't getting past the ceiling. Honey, that ceiling can't stop your prayer. Amen. The devil can't stop it. The world can't stop it. He ain't waiting to see who won the election to see whether he can answer your prayer or not. If you think Donald Trump is going to open up this and make this a Christian and godly nation, you are badly disappointed. Jesus is the only one that can turn it around. Prayer gives you this right here. How many in this church, if you could be honest with yourself, say, what I need more than anything right now is a new beginning? Because the only reason you're praying and the reason you are praying is because where you are ain't working. You need closer to God. You need this answered. You need God to intervene. You need God to step in. You need God to fix your marriage. You need God to fix your family. You need God to fix your kids. You need God to fix your grandkids. You need God to fix your health. You need God to fix your situation. And when you pray, you're saying, I don't want to continue where I'm at. I don't like it where I'm at. It ain't pleasing to God. I ain't got no peace and joy in my life. God, my prayer is a new beginning for me. We all need to hit that reset button, and prayer does that very thing. God takes the past and He puts it where you can't see it no more. God takes the circumstances that ain't working, that ain't fitting. He gives a brand new beginning. He gives you a start over. He makes what ain't right, right. Do you know what the word repent means? We hear it a lot. We even say it. And Lord knows we like to push that little Baptist finger at somebody else. You need to repent. Well, Baptists are good at that, ain't we? You need to repent. All the while there's a nail scarred hand that said, hey, you need to repent. Hear me? Repent means you turn around, go the opposite way. That's what prayer does. Prayer saying, I have messed up, I have sinned, I have done wrong, I've got consequences in my life, I need a new beginning, I need a new start, I need to be on the right path, I need to be walking with God, not away from God, and prayer does that for you. So he's praying. It's a new beginning. But prayer is all. Prayer means this right here. Prayer means that somewhere on the inside of you, when you can't even find the words, when you can't see the end from the beginning, when you can't tell how it's going to go, Prayer means that there's a victory for you, because that answer that comes from God is what you need, not always what you want. And what you need in your life, what I need in my life, what we all need in our life is a victory. God knows we've been walking in defeat long enough. God knows we've been walking in disappointment. God knows we've been walking in it ain't what I wanted. I'm having to deal with what I don't want. But God, I know there's a victory. It's just a prayer away. And what you need to do is get a hold of that, because once it's in His ears, it's in His hands. And when it's in His hands, bless God, He's on His way to reach that nail. Woo, glory! He's on His way to reach that prayer answer to you and say, here's your victory. Here's your new beginning. Here's the answer to your prayer. He is what the two blind men have been praying for, and now their answer's on the way. You see, you and I would never appreciate the mountaintop till we spent some time in the valley. We don't appreciate the still till we've been in the storm. We don't appreciate the answer until we've prayed the prayer that's impossible. Because I can't do it, you can't do it. Doctors can't fix it. Politicians will never fix it. Sometimes mommy and daddy can't fix it. Sometimes the church itself can't fix it. The preacher can't fix it. But there's only one that can fix everything that's wrong. And you, when He comes by, He'll call your name. He knew exactly where they were, where they'd be. And no matter, here's what I like. Jesus don't listen to the crowd. Jesus don't listen to the multitude. Jesus never listens to the devil. He doesn't listen to the world. He only wants to listen to you. They were believers because the first word that came out of their mouth wasn't "Thou Son of David," it was "O Lord." That means, God, I know that You're my Lord. You're my Lord when I was blind. You're asking me what I want. I'm fixing to tell You what I want. Here's what I've been praying for. This is what I need. This is what I want. It all lines up. We want to receive our sight. You see, there's something deep inside my life and my heart and my need, and there is you as well. And when Jesus asks you, you be totally honest with Him. It just aggravates me to no end when people won't be honest with God. What do you want? And you'll give Him something that ain't what you really want, but it's what you think He wants to hear. God says, I already know what you want. What I'm wanting you to do is ask me for it. I want you to be honest with yourself. I want you to be honest with me. And then we got something to talk about. God will never answer anything other than an honest prayer request from you or me. What do you want me to do for you? If you're blind, is it not obvious? But did He not ask anyway? The man that lay there for 38 years at the pool of Bethesda, he asked Him, what would you have me to do? He couldn't tell Him. He began fussing about what ain't been done. And all the while, the man that's lame for 38 years and watched everybody else get their healing, Jesus said, simple. It's right there. I want to walk. I want to be healed. Jesus gave it to him anyway, because when he couldn't ask for it, Jesus knew what he stood in need of. God always knows. When you pray honestly before Almighty God. But notice this, and I would that this is, I guess, the title of the message. The more the crowd said, hush, the Bible says they cried the more. But notice how this was directed. I may have been tempted for God, the first prayer request was, God, would you please shut them up? Do you ever get tired of listening to this right here? One thing every person's got is an opinion. It's amazing how many experts are in this world. It don't matter what you're going through, they know all about it. And there is no shortage of people trying to tell you how to fix your life. But they don't want to hear nothing you got to say about how to fix their life. Amen, preacher. Come on now. I've got an expert. You know him. His name's Jesus. I just turn it over to him. I ain't got to figure it out. He don't need my input. He's already got it. I said, yeah, I saw this coming. Boy, before you ever drew your first birth or your first breath, he said, I saw you 67 years old with a prayer. I already got it. See, the one thing you got to learn to do is don't walk in worry. Don't walk in fret. When you give something to God, let him have it.
Amen.
He ain't going to jerk it out of your hand. You've got to hand it to him. And forget about it.
Amen.
Don't talk about it. Don't talk about your problems. Don't glorify your problems. Glorify God. Because if he don't answer it, all the whining you're going to do ain't going to help no way. I ain't about to glorify problems. I'll glorify my Savior. My problems didn't save me. My problems didn't give me my breath. My problems don't fix me. But my Savior does. And wouldn't we live a whole lot happier if we didn't whine about something? You have no idea who's up here preaching to you. I'm going to tell you a little bit about my last Thursday. I'm a truck driver, retired. I have been all over Knoxville, every hospital, all the way to Middle Tennessee. I can tell you every stairwell. I can tell you every thing how to get to it. I'm going to Clinch Avenue Thursday. Fort Sanders, this building for medical advancements. I don't know what it was, but I know where I was going. Clinch Avenue, been there a bunch of times. That's for Fort Sanders Children's Hospital. Guess where I pulled up to? Park West Hospital. And it ain't till I get out of the truck and I look up and there it is. I said, what am I doing here? This is Park West Hospital. So I fix it. I go to Fort Sanders West. Still in the wrong direction. But I'm making good time. And I look at that and I said, this is not match Clinch Avenue. So I go right back the other direction because I pretty well got it narrowed down. There ain't but two Fort Sanders. I got to get this one right. And I make it. I just walk in that place like I was knew what I was doing the whole time. I'm just confessing to you who you elected up here and you listen to every Sunday. Because I started listening to all the wrong voices, even my own, and it kept putting me in the wrong direction. And all the while, the still small voice said, if you just hush and quit thinking you know where you're going all the time, he said, I'll lead you right in here. And I don't know about you, but I don't care nothing about valet parking. I pull up to that place, and they wanted to valet park my truck. I said, oh, no, you don't. Right there's the parking spot. I can do this. I got that part right. What I'm telling you is this. They cried the more. They're still believing. Even though I'd done two or three things wrong, I still knew where I needed to be. I still knew where I needed to go. I still knew who I needed to see. Sometimes in life, we don't pay attention to the message God's given us. We think we got it figured out. And we begin to follow our own thoughts and our own voice. All I had to do is just shut up long enough, and God led me where I needed to be. But I got it the experience of a lifetime. It's been years since I've been on Cumberland Strip. I weep for America. These are college kids. Oh, God help them. I need to move on. I can't dwell on Cumberland Avenue. I got preaching to do. Here's the thing. Even though they were told to be quiet, even though they were told to shut up, even though they were told to be silent, they prayed the same prayer. When Jesus showed up, they still needed their sight. They still had the same Savior. They still knew exactly what they had been praying for. What I'm telling you is this, when you get the disappointments of life, when even if it's your own stuff, like it was me trying to get to a hospital I've been to a bunch of times, I'm telling you, even when if it's your own doing, if it's somebody else's doing, remember what you're praying for. Remember who you pray to. Don't let the distractions of this world get you off course. What would you have me do unto you? I still want to receive my sight. I still need the same thing I've been praying for. It's still a burden. It still hadn't been answered. God, I ain't changing my mind. That is still my central need. God, I know what I'm praying for. And God said, all right then. They're not going to do nothing for you. What would you have me to do for you? You see, that doesn't change. We still need Jesus. We still need what that thing is that we cannot let go of, because if you still got a burden, you still got that same need, you still got to pray about it and not give up. Is there anybody in this church that real glad this morning that because of somebody else's words, because of time that's went on, because of disappointments, ain't you glad you stayed with the prayer? Ain't it good to know that that marriage has been put back together? That brother, that sister, that son, that daughter, that grandchild is now saved and in the house of God because of you. The crowd said, just give up, quit praying, it ain't never going to happen. Bless God, if there's still life, there's still a burden, there's still a Savior, there's still an answer to your prayer. I'm telling you, don't give up. If you're in here this morning, Miss Dolores, would you come on? I need to quit. If you're in here this morning and you still got something that's nagging on you, that child ain't been saved, that they still on drugs, they're still on drinking, they're still away from God, they're still making silly decisions, they're still messing their life up, you're still dealing with something that's hanging on to you that will not let go, if there's anything that you ain't got peace about this morning, I'm asking you, would you turn it over to Jesus, because He's here in this house, He's waiting for you at this altar this morning, and He's saying, just hush about everything else. Talk to me this time. Don't talk to the crowd. Don't respond to the devil. Don't respond because it ain't happened yet. He's saying, come and talk to me about it and give it to me this morning. Amen. While we stand to our feet. God bless them this morning. Help them as they pray, Lord.
Amen. Can all God's people say amen this morning?
Amen.
All right, then. Anybody got anything on your mind, your heart? Amen. Anybody else? Amen. Sometimes we got to think that we got to do this, that, and other, and sometimes all we got to do is just stand still and let God be God.
Amen.
Amen. Chris, what is Tanner's last name?
Lay.
All right. Next Sunday night, got a young man that's going to come preach for us. Tanner Lay. Met him yesterday. He's at least a foot and a half taller than I am. I looked up at him. But I believe we ought to open up our pulpits for let God still call them preachers. Amen. Amen. All right. Are all minds clear? Tonight, 5 o'clock, there'll probably be coffee. Definitely going to have service at 6 o'clock. Amen. All right. So at this time, Brother Danny Vincent, if you would dismiss us in prayer, then we'll get the kids turned loose. Amen. Come on, youngins. All right. Amen. And they lifted holy hands towards heaven and they shouted,
"Praise!"